So here's my idea. I want to make a recycle game app. So an image is going to appear of an object to be thrown away. And the user can press one of three buttons: a recycle button, compost button, or rubbish button. They'll score 1 point if they're correct, or lose a point if they're wrong. And then if you don't choose a button within 5 seconds, the image will change to a new object and you'll lose a point. First, I'm going to sketch out my idea. So I'll draw a box just to represent the phone. I'll split the screen into three sections. The three buttons will go at the bottom. The score will go at the top. The image will go in the middle. So here I'm just putting a plastic bag. And I'll have a recycle, a composting, and then a rubbish button. Now, hopefully, you already have sketches because you've done a paper prototype, but nonetheless, it's good to have a sketch done before you start building your app in App Inventor. I created a new project in App Inventor. I'm in the designer. Now, you notice under media there are several PNG files. These are the images that are going to be used in the app. This starter template file is available to you in the description, so you can use this with all these images as you go through this tutorial. Let's first go through the different parts of the designer. In the middle here is called the viewer, and it looks like a phone. And this is going to be where we place all the different components or parts to our app. Notice that this little drop down here, we can change it to a tablet, so it will look more like a tablet or a monitor. So if you were actually going to put it on a very large tablet. So we're going to go with a phone, but you can get an idea what your app will look like in different sizes. On the left are all the components that are available to you. So the user interface drawer, where a lot of the visible components are, such as buttons and labels, text boxes, that kind of stuff. We have other drawers here. So, for instance, we'll be using the layout drawer, and we'll talk about that in a minute. Media drawer, where you'd have things like cameras and sounds, drawing and animation, generally used for games and animations, maps, etc. So, there are many, many components available to you, and you just have to look for them in the drawers here on the left. We'll go back to user interface. As you add things to your app, they're going to appear here in the viewer. They'll also appear under components. So, for instance, say I'm going to add a label. It appears here at the top. If I were to add another label, it would drop in below it. The default for any component being added is it's just going to be added in below any other components that you've already added. I only need one label here, so I'll delete the second one. This label is going to be for instructions, and I had forgotten to actually put that in my drawing, but I'm going to give instructions to the user. So let me rename this. I'm going to call it instruction label. Notice that as I've added this, it appears as a component underneath screen one. So screen one is the screen, and all of my components will appear underneath screen one because they're part of screen one. On the right is the properties panel, and this is where you can change some of the different properties or characteristics of each component. So, for instance, I'm going to go down here to text, and it says text for label one, and I'm going to retype what I want the instructions to be. So I want to say press the correct button for the object to be thrown away, and I can say recycle, compost, and rubbish within 5 seconds. So that gives them the general idea of what to do. You can drag this little corner arrow here if you want to see what you've typed. Going back to my drawing, I've decided to put the score at the top. So back in the designer, I want to add the score as two labels that appear next to each other. To do that, I'm going to go to my layout drawer, and this is where we can arrange things a little bit differently than the default. I'm going to drag out a horizontal arrangement, And that really just gives us a box. And that box is a container to put things in. I'm then going to go back to user interface and drag in two labels. So if I drag in one label and then drag in the next, and it's a little bit tricky, but you want to try to make sure that they both fit inside of that box.
With horizontal arrangements, the labels appear next to each other rather than below each other, which is the default.
I do want to change the width, so I'm going to select horizontal arrangement 1 in the components panel. You can also try it in the viewer, but sometimes it's easier in the components panel to select it. And I'm going to make the width fill the parent. The parent of horizontal arrangement 1 is screen 1. Notice that everything under screen 1 is indented. And then label 1 and label 2, which are inside of horizontal arrangement 1, are both indented as well. So for label 1 and label 2, their parent is horizontal arrangement, so it's one level up. And then horizontal arrangement 1 and instruction label, they both have a parent that is screen 1. Mostly we just use that parent terminology for this width and height where you can fill the parent. So you want to make it as big as the parent or the container that it's in. Now we've got these two labels, and so I'm going to rename them. I'm going to call this score label. And then the second one will just be the score, so I'm going to call that score. Score label, I'm going to change its text to say score with a colon and a space. And then
for score,
I'm going to change that to be 0. When we start our game, the score will be 0. These are both a little bit small, so I'm going to go back and I'm going to change their font size. So click on score label, go down to font size, and let's make it 30. So that's much bigger and much more visible. And then I'll do the same for score. I'll change its font size to 30. You're also able to change color and things like that. So if we wanted to, we could make the score, both of them, blue. Whatever color you'd like.
Often for these user interface components, the properties allow you to add your own personality to it by changing them.
The next thing that we want is the image. In our drawing, we had a large image in the middle, which would be the object to be thrown away. So under the user interface, I'm going to drag in an image. Note that it's very small. And let's first rename this. I'm going to call this object. And this is the object to be thrown away.
Let's look at the options for width. The first is automatic, which means whatever it takes to fill it. So if we have an image, it would be the size of the image. If it would be text, it would be the size of the text. The next option is fill parent, which means make it as big as the container it's in. The next option is pixels, and pixels mark the size of a screen, with each pixel representing a dot of color on a screen. So the bigger the screen, the more pixels you'll have. If you look at the drop-down for phone size at the top, it says 505,320, which means the phone is 505 pixels in height and 320 pixels wide. So if I set the height of the image object to 200, it's going to take up 200 out of 505 pixels of the screen, which is a little less than half. Now, if I switch the view to see what it looks like with a tablet, you can see its resolution, which is the name for how many pixels the screen has, is 675 pixels high by 480 pixels wide. So setting the image object to 200 pixels in height makes it smaller on the screen, less than a third of the screen height. It's very good practice when sizing things like this to use the percent field for width and height. Since I want the image to take up about half the screen, that's 50%. You can see that it doesn't matter if I'm using a phone or a larger tablet, the object image is still going to take up 50% or half the screen. So generally, you want to use the percent field instead of pixels, since you won't know which type of device your users will have, and you want the app to look the same on all devices. So let's get back to sizing our object image. I want to make the object
as wide as the whole screen, and then the height, I'm going to make it fill up about half of the height. I still want room down the bottom for my three buttons,
so I'm going to set it to 50%, which is half the height of the screen.
We might have some extra room at the bottom, but I want to leave plenty of room for my three buttons that the user is going to be pressing. That's my object. At the bottom, we want to put those three buttons, and we want to put them next to each other. So just like this horizontal arrangement here, where I could put two labels next to each other, I'm going to go back to layout and drag out another horizontal arrangement. I'm also going to change its width to fill parent, so it's the full width of the screen. And then I'm going to drop in three buttons. So I'll have one button, two buttons, and three buttons. First one will be recycle. So I'm going to call this recycle button. Second one will be the compost, so I'm going to call this compost button. And the third button will be the rubbish button. Rubbish button. Notice that I'm renaming all my components. This is really good programming practice. Rather than, say, button 1, button 2, button 3, when you get over to the blocks editor, you're going to appreciate having them with realistic and descriptive names. Instead of text on these buttons, I'm going to change them so they're picture buttons. Clicking on recycle button, there is a property called image. Right now it says none. If I click on that, all of the media images that I uploaded earlier are available to me. And I've got this recycle white, I believe. Okay, now that's way too big. I'm going to resize this. I want it to take up 1/3 of the screen width. So 33% would be 1/3. Let me change the height to, say, in this case, I'm going to say 100 pixels.
This is a case where we might use pixels.
That looks pretty good. The other thing is I don't want this text in front of it, so I'm going to erase the text. There's our button for recycle. Looking pretty good, and that image appears to fit. One thing you will notice is sometimes you'll have to play around with the images that you add to your app in order to make sure that they fit and that they're not too distorted. Compost button. Let's fit the width to 33%, and we want to make these three buttons the same size. So I'm going to say this is 100 pixels, and we'll do the same for rubbish button, 100 pixels high, and 33% wide. And this one, I'm going to change its image to compost, and I have an image for composting. I will erase the text. The rubbish button, I'm going to change its image to be rubbish. I'm going to erase its text. Another good thing to do at this point is to go ahead and run this. I'm going to run it on my emulator. So if I start up the emulator, you can get a sense of how this is going to look on the phone. This is how it will look on a phone, so I'm pretty happy with the way this looks. If I wanted to have an idea of what the image looks like, what I could do is let's click on Object and set the picture. We're going to be setting the picture using code blocks, but let's just give us an idea. So let's say if we want cardboard box, that's what it would look like in the viewer, but this would be what it would look like in the app. And that's pretty good too. So it fills up that whole space. The idea of this then would be that's a cardboard box which can be recycled. The user would click the recycle button and the score would increase. And then every 5 seconds we're going to change the picture. The other thing that we're going to use for this game is because of that 5 seconds, we need a clock to count down those 5 seconds. The clock will be under the sensor drawer, so I'm going to drag over clock. Note that it jumps to the bottom of the phone and it says a non-visible component. Clock is not visible to the user like labels and pictures and buttons. So it's called non-visible, but it's still a component that will be part of our app. If we look at the properties for clock, we want it to always fire. Timer enabled will mean Is the timer actually counting down?
So you can turn the timer on and off, and when we get to the blocks editor, we'll actually be doing that.
The timer interval is in milliseconds. So what's a millisecond? Well, 1,000 milliseconds is 1 second. So every second contains 1,000 milliseconds. So we want our timer to go off every 5 seconds. So I'm going to change this to 5,000, and that should work for our game. We've got the general layout of our game set up. So now it's time to go over to the blocks editor and start to code it.